गुड इवनिंग एवरी वन, आई एम विष्णु कार्तिक, स्टडिंग सेकेंड इयर MBBS फ्रॉम थागर मेडिकल कॉलेज. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू सी अबाउट द मसल्स ऑफ फोरआर्म, विच इज ऑफन नेग्लेक्टेड द फर्स्ट इयर एज वी डोंट फाइंड टाइम टू रिवाइज इट ड्यूरिंग द एग्जाम्स. इट इन दिस मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक इन द वाइवा एस्पेक्ट, एज इन डिस्कशंस दे विल कीप द फोरआर्म एंड आस्क अबाउट द फ्लेक्सर्स एंड एक्सटेंसर्स एंड इवन सब क्वेश्चंस. राइट, एंड इन थियरी ऑल्सो दे मे आस्क सम इंपॉर्टेंट मसल्स for which we should write the origin, insertion, nerve supply and action along with a diagram. Okay, let's go into it. In this session, I'm going to give a small introduction about the forearm muscles, how they are arranged, and then about the compartments of the muscle, anterior and posterior compartments, then give a summary of all these. First, in the introduction, this is a cross section of forearm. From the outer aspect, it is covered by skin, superficial fascia and deep fascia. This green color line is the deep fascia, which sends septa inside the muscular layers to the bones, radius and ulna. Right? So on the lateral side, this is the lateral intramuscular septum, which is arranged from the deep fascia to the radius, and then in the medial side, it is a medial intramuscular septum which arises from the deep fascia to the ulna, right? And then between the radius and ulna, there is one ligament. It is called as the interosseous ligament, between two bones, interosseous, right? So it is called as interosseous ligament. These three ligaments, this one, two septums and one ligament, they form the anterior and posterior compartment. So anterior to these structures is the anterior compartment, and posterior to this is the posterior compartment. Right? First, this should be understood for studying the anterior and posterior compartments. Anterior compartment is also called as flexor compartment because all the muscles act to flex the wrist joint. Right? Similarly, posterior compartment muscles are called as extensor muscles, as it will extend the wrist joint. Not only the wrist joint, they also extend the fingers, metacarpophalangeal joints, interphalangeal joints. Next, before reading muscles, we should know some common points to make them effective, right? You should know about the common flexor origin. From the name, you see common flexor origin. Common is, it is common for most of the muscles. Nearly flexor compartment, all the muscles have same origin. That is the medial epicondyle of humerus, right? Similarly, for extensor muscles, we have a common extensor origin where most of the superficial muscles arise from here, right? Which is the lateral epicondyle of humerus. Next, we have the carpal bones, right? In the carpal bones, each bone has some specific feature which should be written in the exams for getting more marks. Okay. Some of the carpal bones, here I mentioned the special structures like the hook of Hammett, tubercle of scaphoid and the crest of trapezium. They are just mild elevations present in the bone surfaces which give attachments to the various structures like the flexor retinaculum and also various other tendons of muscles, right? Let us see where they are. This is the flexor retinaculum, which is present above the carpal bones attached to them, right? It is attached to pisiform, hook of Hammett, crest of trapezium and tubercle of scaphoid. It forms the carpal tunnel between this flexor retinaculum and the carpal bones. There is a gap, right? Hence, these structures are important. These names are important for writing. See, then we saw about the common flexor origin. See here, all the flexors arise from here. Mostly superficial flexors arise from the common flexor origin, which is the medial epicondyle of humerus. Okay. Similarly, here there's a common extensor origin, which is the lateral epicondyle of humerus on the dorsal side. Right? Yes. We are going to see about the flexor compartment now. Okay. There are 8 muscles in the flexor compartment, which are arranged as 2 groups, right? Superficial and deep. Superficial muscles are 5 in number and deep muscles are 3 in number. Since there are so many muscles, we need to remember each and every muscle's name.
and also its location, either it is superficial or deep. For that, easy way to remember is heavy work muscles are placed deeply. Mostly, most of the complex works that we do in our day-to-day life are carried out by the deep muscles, right? We will see it afterwards in the summary, how to apply this in the remembrance of all the muscle names. Okay? First, let us say all the names of the muscles, then we go on about the description deeply, right? First, we will see the superficial muscles. They are listed as pronator teres, flexor carpi radialis, palmaris longus, flexor digitorum superficialis, and flexor carpi ulnaris. There are easy ways to remember these, as we keep our four fingers on our forearm, so that the first finger represents pronator teres, which is one of the boundary of the cubital fossa, right? It runs from medial to lateral aspect. So first finger is represents pronator teres. Then in the rest three fingers, the finger which is present the most medial side, present towards the ulna, right? Hence it is called as flexor carpi ulnaris. It is present in the flexor compartment and it is present in the ulnar side. So flexor carpi ulnaris, which is this last finger, right? Similarly, on the radial side, flexor carpi radialis, flexor compartment and gone towards the radial aspect, that is towards the thumb, right? In the between these two muscles, in the center, there lies a muscle called as palmaris longus, right? Goes towards the palm, so it is called palmaris longus. Thus, it is easy to remember all these five muscles. We have flexor digitorum superficialis between these palmaris longus and the flexor carpi ulnaris. It is present a layer deep to these muscles, and hence it is not visible in the cadavers on the superficial aspect, right? When we lift this palmaris longus, flexor carpi ulnaris and some part of flexor carpi radialis, we can see the flexor digitorum superficialis completely. Okay, let us see in detail about each and every muscle. First, we will see about the pronator teres. From its name, pronator teres. Teres means a round long muscle. Pronator means its action, pronation. We know that the king's pronate and beggar's supinate. As the beggars, while receiving any object, their hands will be in the position of supination, and while kings, when giving any object, their hands will be in the position of pronation, right? Hence its name. Here, this causes the movement of pronation. Hence, it is called as pronator teres. So, we first learnt about the action before the origin insertion, right? Let's go into the origin. We always know that flexor compartment muscles arise from common flexor origin, which is the medial epicondyle of humerus. Since pronator teres has two heads, the superficial head arises from the common flexor origin, while the deep head arises from the medial aspect of coronoid process of ulna. That is, it has two processes, right? Olecranon process and coronoid process. Coronoid process is present anteriorly, of which medial side of the coronoid process gives origin to the deep head of pronator teres. Since it goes from medial to lateral aspect, medial aspect of coronoid process gives origin, right? Easy to remember, right? Let's go to the insertion. This is inserted into the middle 1/3 of shaft of radius, but where, since it goes from medial to lateral, it is inserted on the lateral aspect of middle 1/3 of radial shaft. Okay, so origin, insertion, action, all are easy, right? We got it. Next, nerve supply. Most of the flexor muscles are supplied by median nerve. I will tell it at the end which muscle is supplied by ulnar nerve, so that you will get a clear cut idea. Here we have some special points about the pronator teres. Median nerve, right? I said nerve, which innervates this muscle, passes between these two heads of pronator teres. Let me see in the diagram. Here, this superficial head is cut, and then the deep head is visible, right? Between the superficial and deep head, we can see the nerve. This is the presence of median nerve between the two heads of pronator teres. It has a clinical importance. Why is it? Because when the pronator teres is overly used, okay, the muscle gets inflamed, so that it will compress the median nerve present between them. This causes the alteration of function of this nerve below this point, right? So it has a clinical importance at this site. Similarly, we can see a brachial artery giving a branch of
ulnar artery here below the deep head of frontal teres, right? So it can be useful in the spot test when asked, right? So this is about frontal teres. We learned about the origin, common flexor origin, and the medial border of coronoid process, insertion on the lateral aspect of middle 1/3 of radius, nerve supply by the median nerve, and the action is pronation. But here only pronation is possible only in the rapid movements, right? This is not the chief pronator of forearm, okay? Chief pronator is the pronator quadratus, which is a deep muscle. I said earlier that most of the complex functions are performed by the deep muscles, so that too is performed by deep muscle, right? Next we will go about to see flexor carpi radialis. Let's get an overview about this muscle. Flexor, present in the flexor compartment. Carpi means this gets inserted into the one of the carpal bones or metacarpals. Radialis, it means that it is present on the radial aspect, right? So flexor carpi radialis means it is a flexor compartment muscle, goes to the carpal bones, present on the radial aspect, right? Let's see about the origin insertion. Origin, it arises from the same common origin for flexors, that is the medial epicondyle of humerus here, right? Then insertion, here I want to tell you about something interesting to remember. When there is a carpi radialis, carpi ulnaris in both flexor and extensors, how to remember its insertion points, right? It is very easy to remember as carpi radialis muscles always insert on second and third metacarpals, while carpi ulnaris insert on the fifth metacarpal. Okay, very easy, no? That similar aspect is here. See here, our insertion is present on the second and third base of metacarpals, right? So origin is the common flexor origin, and insertion is the second and third metacarpals. Nerve supply by the median nerve, and its action is easily explained as flexor carpi radialis acts with the same compartment muscle, that is flexor carpi ulnaris, which is present on the ulnar aspect, right? These two muscles, when contract together, they will cause the flexion of the wrist, as they are present, as they are inserted in the carpal bones, right? So they will flex the wrist easily when acting together. When acts with brachioradialis, brachioradialis is an extensor compartment muscle, which we will be learning later, present just lateral to it. They both are present on the radial side. As a result, they will cause the abduction of the wrist, right? Both when contract together, the extensor and the flexor will move this aspect towards this side, right? Hence it is called its abduction, movement away from the body. So with brachioradialis it causes abduction, and with flexor carpi ulnaris causes flexion. There is another special feature. Its tendon lies lateral to the radial artery. We are here. Its tendon lies lateral to the radial artery. Hence, it is easy to identification of the radial artery near the wrist. Next, we are going to say about palmaris longus. Let's discuss the name. Palmaris. Palm goes to the palm. Longus. It's a long muscle. Right? This is the name. Palmaris longus. It originates from the same common flexor origin, right? Goes towards the palm. Since the name has palm, it goes towards the palm while crossing the flexor retinaculum superficially, not under the superficial to the flexor retinaculum, and gets expanded as palmar aponeurosis, right? That is, joins the base of palmar aponeurosis. These are the origin insertion of palmaris longus. It does not have any significant role, as its action is just to make our palmar aponeurosis tense while holding some objects, while gripping something like that, right? It is also supplied by the median nerve, and it has some special features, like clinical importance, as when there is any trauma, any bike accident, for example, there will be tendons are cut, and we need to replace those tendons. The surgeons can use this tendon of palmaris lungs, that is, as it has a long tendon, can take his tendon to be inserted into some other tendon transplants, right? So it is used as a tendon grafting by surgeons, as it has not a major role to play in the muscular contraction, right? And this muscle resembles the plantaris muscle of the lower limb, which is also tendon like muscle. Next we are going to see about flexor carpi ulnaris. It has its origin from two heads, humeral head and ulnar head, right? Humeral head arises from the common flexor origin, while the ulnar head arises from the medial border of olecranon process. Since this muscle is more medial present in the flexor compartment, it is originated from the medial border of the olecranon process, right? Its insertion is different. Since the name, I suggested that carpi ulnaris muscles always insert on the base of fifth metacarpal. Here we can see that first it inserts on the pisiform bone, then with two ligaments, piezohyoid ligament and piezometacarpal ligament. It attaches itself with the hook of hamate and also the base of fifth metacarpal, right? Since it is flexor carpi ulnaris, it will be inserted on the base of fifth metacarpal. Ulnaris means fifth metacarpal, radialis means second and third metacarpal, right? Remember these points, it will be easy for origin insertion. Next is action. Action is along with the flexor carpi radialis muscle, which is also present in the flexor compartment, helps in flexion of the wrist, right? Similarly, on the same side, ulnar side, on the extensor compartment, right, on the opposite, okay, there will be present an extensor carpi ulnaris. While these two muscle acts, it will cause adduction, movement of the wrist towards the body, right? These are the actions of flexor carpi ulnaris muscle. Next, it is supplied by ulnar nerve. Since ulnar nerve passes between the two heads of this flexor carpi ulnaris, it also has the same problem that when compressed between these two heads, its function is altered below this point. Next, tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris gives an idea of where the ulnar artery is present. Ulnar artery is just medial to the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. Next, flexor digitorum superficialis, which is the bulkiest muscle present in the superficial compartment. It is also regarded as present in the intermediate compartment, as is just below these four muscles of superficial compartment, right? So it has a very strong origin from medial to lateral side, as from the common flexor origin, then attaches to the medial collateral ligament, which is also called as deltoid ligament, present on the elbow joint, right? Next, it arises from the tendinous arch, that is present between the ulna and the radius. Also, it arises from the medial margins of coronoid process and anterior oblique line of radius. So trace a line towards from medial to lateral aspect with the following features of the bones, you will get the origin of flexor digitorum superficialis. Then insertion of this muscle is somewhat different. See the name, flexor digitorum superficialis, superficial compartment, flexor compartment. So flexor superficialis, digitorum means supplies the four digits, that is medial four digits except the thumb. Flexor digitorum superficialis has its four tendons going splitting into the four tendons on the metacarpals. While reaching the proximal phalanx, it splits into two as superficial and deep layers, and on reaching the middle phalanx, it again splits into two to be inserted on both the sides of the middle phalanx, right? This is the insertion of flexor digitorum superficialis. That is, the tendon comes for a single digit, then it divides into superficial and deep, then it divides into two parts to be inserted into both sides of the digits. Then nerve supply, it is by the median nerve as always. Its action is, since it is inserted on the middle phalanx of medial four digits, contraction of this muscle causes the flexion of proximal interphalangeal joint. The superficial muscles is completed. We are going to be see the deep muscles. There are three deep muscles in the forearm flexor compartment. They are called as flexor pollicis longus, flexor digitorum profundus, pronator quadratus. First, we'll say about the flexor digitorum profundus. Flexor means flexor compartment, digitorum means supplying the digits, and the profundus means located deeply. So, on the flexor aspect of forearm, it is the most deeply located muscle. Since it supplies the digits, that is the medial four digits, it originates mainly from the ulna bone, right? So, it originates from the medial side of the olecranon and coronoid process of ulna. Then, also it originates from the upper 3/4 of anterior and medial surfaces of shaft of ulna and adjoining point of intraosseous membrane, and also upper 3/4 of posterior border of ulna. This is the origin of flexor digitorum profundus, right? So it mainly originates from ulna, from the top to the middle, in the order of medial end of olecranon process, coronoid process, then upper 3/4 of anterior and medial surface of shaft, then upper 3/4 of posterior border. So its origin surrounds the bone and goes towards the intraosseous membrane to the fingers. Its insertion is similar to the flexor digitorum superficialis, and it perforates the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis to be continued as the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis and insert in the distal phalanx. After the flexor digitorum superficialis insert into the middle phalanx on both sides, this tendon passes straight in between those two tendons to be inserted on the distal phalanx. Since it is inserted in the distal phalanx, its action is the flexion of distal interphalangeal joint. It is the only muscle in the forearm to be supplied by the two nerves, that is median and ulnar nerve, where the medial half of this muscle is supplied by the ulnar nerve, while the lateral half is supplied by the median nerve. Special features of this muscle are dual innervation, most powerful muscle of forearm. It provides origin to the lumbricals, and it has the gripping power. And this muscle gives the gripping power so that our hands can hold objects. I already told that most of the deep muscles perform the most complex functions, right? So flexor digitorum profundus provide the gripping power of the hand. Next, we are going to see about flexor pollicis longus. It is a laterally located muscle, so its origin is from the radius bone, right? It originates from upper 2/3 of anterior surface of radius below the oblique line and adjoining part of the intraosseous membrane. So it just arises below the oblique line, remember like that, okay? It arises on the radius as it is present on the radial side. See, its insertion is present on the distal phalanx of thumb. It is responsible for the flexion of thumb, right? So it is most important muscle as it gives many functions of thumb. Nerve supply is by the anterior intraosseous nerve, which is nothing but the deep branch of the median nerve. It is tested by flexing the thumb against the resistance. Next is the pronator quadratus. This is the most important muscle as it causes the function of pronation, right? It originates from the oblique line, the lower 1/4 of anterior surface of ulna, and is inserted in the lower 1/4 of anterior surface of radius. It goes from ulna to radius as well. Contraction, it has to bring the radius towards the ulna to cause pronation, right? So it originates from ulna to radius. It is supplied by the anterior intraosseous nerve and it causes pronation. Then for looking the summary, here we have the flexors of forearm. Starting from here, this is the pronator teres going towards this side, and where this is the cubital fossa, whose medial boundary is found by the pronator teres. Then is the flexor carpi radialis muscle going towards this thumb, then flexor carpi ulnaris muscle on this end. Between these two is the flexor palmaris longus, and when we lift these muscles, we can see the flexor digitorum superficialis. The deep muscles are pronator quadratus from the ulna to radius. Flexor pollicis longus arising from the radius to supply the thumb, and flexor digitorum profundus arising from the ulna to insert into the all the four digits. There is an easy way to remember the nerve supply for the forearm muscles, right? First, let us divide the medial 1/4 of the hand and the lateral 3/4 of the hand. Okay, this is supplied by median nerve, while this portion is supplied by ulnar nerve. This is a rough estimate. Don't take it as a fact, but it is just. I'm telling this to remember this, as most only the muscle of flexor carpi ulnaris is completely supplied by this ulnar nerve, right? Because it is the most medially located muscle, right? And also flexor digitorum profundus, due to its extensive course, its medial half is completely under this flexor carpi ulnaris muscle, so it is supplied by the ulnar nerve. While its lateral half, which lies in this area, is supplied by the median nerve, right? So this is the thing to remember: nerve supply of flexors of forearm. All the muscles are supplied by median nerve, except for the flexor carpi ulnaris and medial half of flexor digitorum profundus, right? So thus we completed the flexors of forearm. Now we are going to see about the extensor compartment. It has 12 muscles. There we had 8 muscles, but here we have 12 muscles. It is also divided as superficial and deep. Superficial has 7 muscles and deep layer has 5 muscles. Here there is no dual nerve supply. All the muscles are supplied by the radial nerve. So let us list the muscles. Here we can divide these muscles into lateral group and posterior group, as lateral group of muscles overlap the flexors on the lateral aspect. So we can see the brachioradialis on the flexor aspect of forearm, but it belongs to the extensor compartment. Since it is present more laterally, it appears to be present on the flexor compartment, right? So here are the three muscles, namely brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, and the extensor carpi radialis brevis. These three muscles are most laterally located, and hence they are called as lateral group of superficial extensors. Similarly, the rest four muscles, the onchonius, extensor carpi ulnaris, extensor digiti minimi, extensor digitorum, these four muscles are located completely posteriorly, and hence they are called as posterior group of superficial muscles. Here, all the superficial muscles cross the elbow joint to reach its insertion point, right? Now we are going to see about brachioradialis. From its name, brachioradialis, it starts from brachium, that is humerus, and inserts into the radius, radialis. So it gets inserted into the radius. So it originates from the upper 2/3 of the lateral supracondylar line, which is the line just extending above the lateral epicondyle of humerus. In the upper 2/3 of this line gives origin to the brachioradialis muscle. So it originates from the arm itself and gets inserted into the radius just above the styloid process on the lateral aspect, right? Since this muscle is located laterally, it originates from the lateral aspect and inserts into the lateral aspect, lateral supracondylar line to the lateral aspect of radius just above the styloid process. Its actions are flexion of elbow, then pronation of supinator forearm in the mid-prone position. Mid-prone position is the position in which your thumb faces upwards and your little finger faces downwards, right? So from this position, either supination or pronation, both are carried out by the brachioradialis muscle, right? This is most important in eliciting this function. Next, we are going to say about extensor carpi radialis longus. See the name, extensor, belongs to the extensor compartment. Carpi ends in the carpal bones. Radialis in the radial side. So extensor carpi radialis longus. It originates from the
lower one third of lateral supracondylar line. So upper two third gives rise to brachioradialis. On the same line, it begins in the lower one third. So these three muscles of lateral compartment arise from a single line, right? Upper two thirds form brachioradialis, lower one third form extensor carpi radialis longus, and the common extensor origin gives rise to the, that is the lateral epicondyle. That gives origin to the extensor carpi radialis brevis that we will see later. So this muscle originates from up lower one third of lateral supracondylar line just above the lateral epicondyle of humerus. It gets inserted on the base of second metacarpal on the dorsal aspect. I already told that carpi radialis muscle always insert on second and third, but here longus muscle gets inserted on the second metacarpal, and brevis muscle, brevis means small, brevis muscle gets inserted into the third metacarpal, right? Its action is along with the extensor carpi ulnaris. We saw that flexor carpi ulnaris along with the flexor carpi radialis both flex the wrist joint, right? Similarly here, extensor carpi radialis and extensor carpi ulnaris, they extend the wrist joint, right? Similarly, flexor carpi radialis assist extensor carpi radialis longus to cause abduction of wrist. We saw this action already in the muscle flexor carpi radialis, right? Next we are going to see about extensor carpi radialis brevis. As I already told, it gets originated from the common origin of extensor muscles from the lateral epicondyle, and it also arises from the lateral ligament of elbow joint, right? Insertion, I already told that radialis muscles always gets inserted in second and third metacarpal. Here longus gets inserted in the second and the brevis gets inserted in the third metacarpal, that is the awesome of base of third metacarpal on tubercle, right? Nerve supply, here it is the first for these two muscles. The nerve supply is radial nerve, which directly supplies this muscle. From here, radial carpi, extensor carpi radialis brevis, the radial nerve is divided into superficial and deep parts. The deep part is called as posterior interosseous nerve. This posterior interosseous nerve, before piercing the supinator muscle, supplies this extensor carpi radialis brevis. Its action is same as that of extensor carpi radialis longus. Both are same muscle, but that is a long muscle, this is a small muscle. So the action is same. That is, along with the extensor carpi ulnaris, it causes extension of the wrist. Along with the flexor carpi radialis, it will give the action of abduction. Next, we are going to see about extensor digitorum, which has its origin from the common extensor origin, that is the dorsal aspect of lateral epicondyle of humerus. It gets inserted into the medial four digits, but its insertion is inserted into proximal and distal phalanx by the dorsal digital expansion, which is a modification of hand. So this gets inserted into the dorsal digital expansions to get inserted into the proximal and distal phalanx, right? In the flexor compartment, we had flexor digitorum superficialis and flexor digitorum profundus. Here we have only extensor digitorum, so it supplies both the proximal and distal phalanx, right? Then it is supplied by the posterior interosseous nerve. From here, all the muscles are supplied by posterior interosseous nerve except the amconius, which is supplied by nerve to amconius, which is a direct branch of radial. Right. Its action is extension of the medial four digits, similar to its name, right? Next is extensor digiti minimi. This is a muscle that supplies the little finger. It gets originated from the common extensor origin, similar to that of the digitorum, but it inserts just medial to that of the extensor digitorum muscle, right? So both have the same origin and same in similar insertion, right? It also inserts into the dorsal digital expansions, right? Its action is to the extension of little finger and helps in wrist extension also, right? Next is extensor carpi ulnaris. It gets originated from the common extensor origin, that is the lateral epicondyle, and also the aponeurosis, which arises from the upper two-thirds of the posterior border of ulna, which gives origin also for the flexor carpi ulnaris as well as flexor digitorum profundus, right? So it arises on the posterior aspect as well as some part of the medial aspect, right? Then it is inserted onto, since it is a carpi ulnaris, it gets inserted on the tubercle of base of fifth metacarpal on the dorsal aspect. Since extensor side, it is present on the dorsal aspect, right? Then nerve supply, it is always by the radial nerve, the posterior interosseous nerve, and its action is along with extensor carpi radialis, both muscles, longus and brevis, causes extension, and along with the flexor carpi ulnaris, it adducts the wrist. All these carpi muscles have similar action. Just remember either flexor or extensor muscles actions, so that all the actions can be easily memorized. Next, we are going to see about the small muscle anconius, which origin is from the common extensor origin, that is the back of lateral epicondyle. Right? Then gets inserted into the lateral side of the olecranon process. Since it lies lateral, so it inserts into the lateral side of olecranon process and overlapping the posterior surface of the ulna. Right? So it gets originated from the lateral epicondyle, goes towards posteriorly on the ulna to get into the posterior border and as well as the lateral aspect of olecranon process. Now it is supplied by the radial nerve by nerve to anconius, which arises from the spiral groove. It is a weak extensor of elbow which does not have any significant role. So on the summary, you can see that all the muscles here, starting from here, this is the brachioradialis muscle. That is forming the bulk of the muscle on the radial aspect. Then we can see the flexor carpi, extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis along with the extensor digitorum muscle. Then we can see the extensor carpi ulnaris and a small muscle called anconius here. So when asked in spot test, can be easily answered by seeing the location of the muscle and where the tendon goes, right? Next, we are going to see about deep muscles of forearm. There are 5 deep muscles of forearm. They are supinator, abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, and extensor indicis. Let us first see about the 3 outcropping muscles, which are abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus, and extensor pollicis brevis. They are called as outcropping muscles. Why? Because they help in the outward movement of the thumb, right? Abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis lie more laterally, while extensor pollicis longus lies medially. These are the boundaries of the anatomical snuff box of which the content is the radial artery. And the anatomical snuff box is located on the dorsum of the hand, just at the base of the thumb, okay, at the junction of the wrist and hand. Now let us see about the origin and insertion of each and every muscles, and then we will see about the movements in detail. And at last, we will see about the supinator, which has as an origin insertion in a confusing way. I will explain it clearly. Okay. Now we will go on to the abductor pollicis longus. See the name, abductor pollicis longus. Abductor means abduction, that is movement away from the body. Pollicis means supplies the thumb, and longus means it is a long muscle. Since it is a long muscle, it is placed at the higher level on the forearm, right? See its origin, it originates from the posterior surface of ulna, interosseous membrane, and posterior surface of radius. So since it is a long muscle and it's more bulkier, it originates from both ulna and radius and intervening the interosseous membrane. See, its insertion is found on the radial side of base of first metacarpal, which helps in the movement of the thumb towards the lateral side of the body. So its insertion is placed at the laterally on the radial side of first metacarpal. Next, we'll see about extensor pollicis brevis. This muscle is attached, since it is a brevis muscle, it is short, right? So it attaches from the radius to the base of proximal phalanx of thumb, okay, whereas the longest muscle, extensor pollicis longus, arises from the ulna and reaches to the distal phalanx. It is long
so it is called as longus. This muscle is short, so it originates from the radius itself and ends in the proximal phalanx of thumb. Thus, you can remember the origin insertion of these three muscles, that is the outcropping muscles. Next, we have another special muscle called as extensor indicus, which is from the name itself we can understand that extensor means extension of the finger, while indicus is the index finger. So index finger has a special extension muscle, right? So it originates from the ulna and interosseous membrane, which goes and inserts on the ulnar side of the extensor digitorum tendon for index finger. So similarly, we had the extensor digiti minimi that also runs along the ulnar side of the extensor digitorum tendon. This muscle also goes to the ulnar border of the extensor digitorum tendon and inserts on the index finger into the dorsal digital expansion. That's all about the deep muscles. So we saw about here four deep muscles, which are the abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis and extensor indicus. Next we'll go about see the actions. I already told that the actions along with the origin and insertion, here I listed them. Supinator, from its name itself, it is supination of forearm. Abductor pollicis longus abducts the thumb. Extensor pollicis brevis extend the thumb at metacarpophalangeal joint and carpometacarpal joint. Extensor pollicis longus extend the thumb and help in extension of the wrist. Extensor indicus extend the index finger and helps in extension of wrist. These are the actions that are based on the names of these muscles, so it can be easily remembered. Here I have demonstrated a picture to show the all these muscles. This is a supinator, this is the abductor pollicis longus, along with the abductor pollicis longus is the extensor pollicis brevis, then extensor pollicis longus and then extensor indicus. Here I want to tell about the supinator muscle, which has a special origin and insertion. Usually supinator originates from the lateral epicondyle of humerus, which is called as the common extensor origin, and then it also arises from the radial collateral ligament and annular ligament of radius. Its origin is also found along the supinated crest of the ulna and also adjoining point of the triangular area, which is present near the supinator crest. Insertion. This muscle originates from the lateral side of the ulna. Okay, this is the medial side and this is the lateral side. It originates from the middle of the lateral side, so that it passes first posteriorly, then covers it laterally, then anteriorly. So first it arises laterally from the ulna, then goes towards posteriorly, then laterally and then anteriorly, covering the entire radius. This is the insertion of supinator muscle. Okay, since it has two heads, one head is the humeral and radial head, while another head is the ulnar head. Between these two heads, there is present the radial nerve. Radial nerve means that is a branch of radial nerve, which is a deep branch of radial nerve. Superficial branch of radial nerve passes along the superficial muscles. So these are the special insertion of supinator muscle, so that one cannot get confused. Now we can see the summary of all the extensor muscles, the superficial and deep. So from superficial muscle, this is the brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi ulnaris, extensor carpi radialis brevis present along this muscle. They are the lateral extensors. The posterior extensors are extensor digitorum, extensor carpi ulnaris and anconius. There is a trick to remember all these names of the muscles. Superficial muscles are placed laterally three muscles, central two muscles, medial two muscles. It is easy to remember. The lateral three muscles we already saw: brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis. These three muscles are present more laterally. Then two central muscles, anconius and extensor digitorum. Always the digitorum muscle is always present in the center, and also anconius is also present near the center. Medially there are two muscles, extensor digiti minimi, which is on the ulnar side, and extensor carpi ulnaris, it is also on the ulnar side. So it is easy to remember. Here radialis means on the radial side, brachioradialis. So all the radialis muscles are on the lateral side, ulnaris muscles are on the ulnar side. Thus we can easily remember all the superficial muscles. For deep muscles, I already told that they do the more complex functions. Then we can remember it as supination for supinator. Thumb has three muscles, that is the outcropping muscles, abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, extensor pollicis longus, which is in the anatomical snuff box, and the extensor indices for index finger. Here, extensor digiti minimi is a superficial muscle, while extensor indices is a deep muscle. Why is it like that? It is because extension of little finger is not so important movement, while extension of index finger is very important, as we use it for a very complex functions. So summary for flexors, once again we see it, deep flexors, pronator quadratus, flexor pollicis longus, and the flexor digitorum profundus, these three muscles. In superficial muscles, we can remember it by keeping our four fingers on our forearm. More goes towards from medial to lateral side is the pronator teres, and on ulnar side is the ulnaris, radial side is the radialis, and the central is the palmaris longus. Similarly, between the palmaris longus and the flexor carpi ulnaris present is the flexor digitorum superficialis. You can see it here also. Here see the lateral extensors also occupy the flexor compartment laterally. Okay, here pronator teres, flexor carpi radialis, flexor carpi ulnaris, palmaris longus. Already told that the nerve supply for this three hand of part of the forearm laterally is supplied by median nerve, while one and half part of the forearm is supplied by ulnar nerve. This part consists of two muscles, that is flexor carpi ulnaris completely and flexor digitorum profundus medial half, because it is a very large muscle and has a dual innervation. Next, we'll see about the structures which are arranged at the wrist in the order. So, on the ventral aspect of the wrist, we can see the flexor retinaculum, above which lies the palmaris longus muscle, which ends as the palmar aponeurosis. Then, on each side, there is a blood vessel, namely the ulnar artery and radial artery. And we can see the tendons arrangement. Here, the ulnar side presents the flexor carpi ulnaris, on the radial side is the flexor carpi radialis, and between the palmaris longus and flexor carpi ulnaris is the flexor digitorum superficialis. This is the arrangement of the structures of the wrist. Why is it important? Because it is very important to know which structures get cut during the suicidal cuts, right? And how deep is the suicidal cut. So whenever there is a cut place here, first, vessels damaged are ulnar artery and the radial artery. When the cut is more deep at the ulnar side, ulnar artery is damaged, and when the cut is more deep at the radial side, radial artery is damaged, so that there will be profuse bleeding. And then tendons which are cut are, first is palmaris longus tendon will get cut, and the flexor digitorum superficialis is rare to be get cut because it is present deeply, right? Then median nerve, it is a somewhat superficial structure which is present above the flexor digitorum superficialis tendon and just below the flexor retinaculum. So it has the more probability of getting damaged. When the median nerve gets damaged, there will be loss of functions of the short muscles of hand. These are the structures arranged at the wrist on the palmar aspect. On the dorsal aspect, these tendons are arranged in the form of a tunnel under the extensor retinaculum. We can see the three outcropping muscles, abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, and extensor pollicis longus. These three muscles are intervened by extensor carpi radialis brevis and extensor carpi radialis longus.
Since these muscles terminate on the metacarpal bones, these three tendons go along the anatomical snuffbox so that they appear nearer, right? But it is intervened between tensor carpi, radialis longus and tibialis. Then we have extensor digitorum, extensor indices, anterior interosseous artery and the posterior interosseous nerve into a single compartment, that is the fourth compartment. Then on the ulnar side, we have extensor carpi ulnaris, and just lateral to it is the extensor digiti minimi. So these are the structures arranged at the wrist on the dorsal aspect. Now yeah, we can see some clinical points associated with it, not directly, but somewhat associated with it. See the terms tennis elbow and golfer's elbow. Tennis elbow, it is most commonly seen in tennis players, so it is called as tennis elbow. Why it is happening? Because tennis, while playing tennis, extension of the hand occurs suddenly to hit the ball. So when they suddenly extend their forearm, the forearm muscles pull out their origin so that the lateral epicondyle get fractured, right? Which is the extensor compartment common origin, right? So while doing fast extension, this common origin is pulled away from its position so that it may get fractured lateral epicondylitis, which is the inflammation of the lateral epicondyle, which may be caused due to fracture. There are many other causes, but it also is a cause of lateral epicondylitis, which is called as tennis elbow, easy to remember. Similarly, golfer's elbow. Golf players usually forcefully flex their arm. So the flexors of forearm get contracted rapidly. So actually, similar to the tennis elbow, it pulls its origin, which is the medial epicondyle. Right? It is a flexor, common flexor origin. So when the medial epicondyle is pulled suddenly, there may be a fracture of the medial epicondyle. So that medial epicondylitis is caused. It is the inflammation of medial epicondyle. So these are the two points you need to know. Right? Thank you for your patient listening.